Elixir, A History of Water and Humankind by Brian Fagan. Narrated by James Langton. Copyright 2011 by Brian Fagan. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Bloomsbury, USA, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto.
"Now, John," quoth Nicholas, "I will not lie. I have found in mine astrology, as I have looked in the moon bright, that now a Monday next at quarter night shall fall a rain, and that so wild and wood that half so great was never Noah's flood. This world," he said, "in less than an hour shall all be drowned, so hideous is the shower. Thus shall mankind drench and lose her life."
Geoffrey Chaucer, The Miller's Tale, circa 1390 CE. The tending of the rice plants, from the time of replanting to the harvest, the sensuality of wading in the warm mud, the concentration of nurturing the fragile plants as one would a child, the sense of continuity one gets from finding under one's fingers, during the weeding of the new crop, the half-decayed vestiges of the last crop buried in the terrace to fertilize the soil, all these experiences are experiences of the senses and of the body. Arlette Ottino. Preface. Many years ago, three San hunters and I trekked across southern Africa's arid Kalahari Desert on a searingly hot morning at the end of the dry season. We had stalked dika since dawn, searching unsuccessfully for the elusive antelope in the shady thickets where they settled as the sun climbed in the sky. My companions moved effortlessly, apparently without fatigue or thirst, as I paused to take regular swigs from my water bottle. We came to a dry watercourse and a solitary grove of trees that cast the only shade for miles around in the seemingly waterless landscape. The men paused to rest. One of them examined the dry stream bed and dug into the sand with his wooden digging stick. At first the soil was dry, then it was damp, then, miraculously, water appeared. The hunter crouched, swept the precious liquid up with his hands, and drank deeply. His companions followed, so did I, allowing the water to flow over my sweating face and hands. I have never felt such a close, sensuous connection with the most vital elixir of life. My companions had found water where I had thought there was none. As I got to know them better, I learned something of a new way of looking at the landscape, as an edible and drinkable persona rich in liquid-bearing plants and hidden water. I realized that San existence depended on the distribution of water across the landscape and on the ancient traditions that passed water knowledge from one generation to the next. Since that defining moment, water has always had a profound significance to me. I closed my eyes, listened, and was calmed. The gentle riffle of fountains, of softly flowing water, permeated my senses on that hot afternoon in Granada's Alhambra Palace. I'd walked through the hilltop park, famous for its nightingales, never far from the cooling sounds of running water. A few minutes later, I stood in the court of the pond, where a great rectangular pool lined by myrtles cools the palace. Goldfish swim in the calm waters. When the crowds are gone, the courtyard exudes a profound serenity. Looking out over the city and the sunburnt hills in the distance, I marveled at the lush oasis around me. Later, I learned that the Islamic architects had built a 5-mile, 8-kilometer conduit to bring water from the Darro River. The marvels continued at Janat al-Arif, the General Life Palace, across a nearby ravine. Nasrid Sultan Muhammad III built his summer palace during the first decade of the 14th century. He spared no expense on the magnificent landscaping, one of the oldest surviving Islamic gardens in the world. In the water garden courtyard, arcing jets of water play on your senses as they soar, sparkle, and tumble into a long rectangular pond. This is a place of colonnades and pavilions for leisure and contemplation. Flower beds press on the shimmering pool. The gentle sounds of flowing water add to the impression of paradise. And a human paradise it is, in a harsh land of steep terrain and unpredictable rainfall. The four rivers of the Islamic paradise are rivers of water incorruptible, gardens beneath whose trees rivers flow. The Prophet greets the faithful near a pool in paradise named Kauthar. Granada's resplendent gardens are a green oasis, an ideal of serenity and well-being. They epitomize the close relationship between humans and water, common to all societies on Earth, yet expressed in all manner of ways, some of them startlingly direct and intimate. Water. It caresses and comforts us, provides sustenance and refreshment, is something that humanity has cherished since the beginning of history and means something different to everyone. Water gives us pleasure, as it does at the Alhambra, and has profound sacred qualities. It figures largely in many holy and special places, the soft murmuring of a sacred spring at Delphi in Greece, the reflecting pools of India's Taj Mahal, the reservoirs that surround Angkor Wat in Cambodia, symbolizing the primordial waters of the universe, the font for holy water in Christian cathedrals. Water evokes serenity, harmony, and peaceful existence, the very essence of life, and is commemorated by grand shrines and elaborate rituals in honor of the deities that ensure the continuity of water and life itself. Water. We turn a faucet, and it is there for drinking, something we take completely for granted. So commonplace is water in our daily lives that we are indifferent to it, and have been for a long time. Years ago, Rachel Carson wrote that, in an age when man has forgotten his origins and is blind even to his most essential needs for survival, water, along with other resources, has become the victim of his indifference. Of all the resources that we rely on for survival in today's world, water is the least appreciated and certainly the most misunderstood. For generations, we in the industrial West have just assumed that fresh drinking water is ours to enjoy and to use with dazzling promiscuity in any way we wish. This shouldn't surprise us in an urban age when almost everyone buys their food as packaged commodities from supermarkets, in an era when many city children never see a cow except in pastures. Water is like beef, milk, and pasta, an integral part of our lives that we never think about. A great mistake. History tells us that a defining moment in our use of the Earth's water came with the development of steam power and turbine pumps and the harnessing of fossil fuels during the Industrial Revolution of the late 18th and 19th centuries. For the first time, rapidly expanding and industrializing nations had access to enormous water supplies deep underground, not only for domestic use, but also, and more important, for agriculture and industry. Much of this water mining took hold in arid and semi-arid lands, where lakes, rivers, and springs could never support intensive agriculture or large cities. An orgy of consumption ensued, and continues to this day amid alarming signs in areas like the American West that the supply of underground water is finite and not being replaced at anything like a sustainable rate. In a warming world, where we know that higher temperatures historically tend to be associated with prolonged droughts, the alarm flags of pending water shortages flap in the environmental wind. Yet most of us, living in drier environments, still take water for granted and are in a state of denial about the impending crisis. California is a case in point. It is suffering from multi-year droughts and greatly diminished water supplies, yet its farmers demand full allocations of irrigation water at heavily subsidized prices. Even in good rainfall years, water for all our needs is in short supply. There are calls for desalination plants to supplement nature's supplies in arid environments, as well as for additional dams and more long-distance aqueducts. All of this misses the point. The distribution of the world's water does not match the areas of greatest need, many of which lie in arid and semi-arid lands. A huge academic and popular literature surrounds water and the impending crisis, complete with both general and more specific recommendations. There's been much wringing of hands, but it is only now that water conservation is moving to center stage. It is becoming clear that all of us, whether farmers, governments, manufacturers, or common folk, need to do with less in the future at a far more profound level than sweeping instead of washing down our driveways and watering our lawns less frequently. And it may be here that we can learn from our forebears, for they lived in worlds where water was often scarce, frequently hard to obtain, and treated with great respect. They lived long before the days of pumps and artesian wells, but they knew everything there was to know about making do with finite water supplies and about the force that propels water, gravity. The water managers of the past, whether village farmers, well-connected officials, or court engineers, knew that water is a vital and pitiless force in human life. We can consume, but can never completely tame it. As long ago as the 6th century BCE, the Taoist philosopher Lao Tzu wrote in his Tao Te Ching, "Nothing in the world is as soft and yielding as water." Yet for dissolving the hard and inflexible, nothing can surpass it. The soft overcomes the hard, the gentle overcomes the rigid. History teaches us again and again how right he was. This is a book about human relationships with water in the past, as far as I can tell, the first such work to tackle the subject on a global scale. The idea for such a project revolved in my mind for decades. A seed germinated unconsciously many years ago when I was living among subsistence farmers in Central Africa, a few miles downstream of a major hydroelectric dam. More seeds of the idea took root in later years. While working in Africa, I experienced water deprivation at first hand on many occasions. Walking long miles on archaeological surveys with only a water bottle on my hip when the temperature was in the 80s taught me hard lessons about dehydration. I grew my beard, now 44 years old, after several water-short weeks during fieldwork in Uganda when washing was a real luxury. Years later, crossing the Atlantic in a sailboat was a memorable experience, especially when one of our spare water cans sprang a leak in mid-ocean, a nerve-wracking incident by any standards. More recently, I've done a great deal of bicycling on hot California days. Such trips have reminded me forcibly about the need to keep hydrated. The idea finally took root when my wife, a master gardener, re-landscaped our yard with drought-resistant plants and pulled out all our lawns. Literally the day she completed the project, I heard a radio story about plans for a water park along the drought-challenged coastline south of Los Angeles, and another one about a wealthy resident of our city who spent $30,000 on tanked-in water for his huge lawns. These tales of wasteful consumption tipped the scale. For some years, I had been writing a series of books on ancient climate change, especially on the medieval warm period, and on El Niños, which brought me up against the issue of prolonged droughts time and time again. With my hard-won experiences with water, lengthy exposure to the vicissitudes of ancient climate change, and long decades of teaching archaeology on a global scale, it was time to tackle what was to me a virtually unknown subject. The resulting journey has given me a unique perspective on ancient societies of all kinds and the ways in which they tried to achieve the holy grail of any water manager, whether an African villager or a Chinese irrigation engineer: long-term sustainability. As I researched Elixir, I was struck by how little most people's relationship with water changed over the thousands of years from the first appearance of agriculture some 12,000 years ago into medieval times and beyond. Even today, millions of subsistence farmers live from harvest to harvest, from one rainy season to the next, dependent on unpredictable water supplies from the heavens. This led me to think of the history of humans and water in terms of three stages which overlap with one another. The first goes back to the remote past and endures in places today. Water was an unreliable, often scarce, and always valuable resource, so precious that it was sacred in almost every human society. The second stage began in part about 2,000 years ago, accelerated during the European Middle Ages, and reached fruition during the Industrial Revolution, when water became a mere commodity. Eventually, we developed the technology to pump water from deep beneath the earth and to harvest it on a large scale. Water became something we could exploit without ever worrying about how much we used. Now, during the early 21st century, we are in a third stage where we are finally realizing that water is a finite resource, something to be conserved and treated with a respect, even reverence, that we haven't displayed in a long time. With these broad stages in mind, Elixir revolves around three broad themes. The first is gravity, the fact that water flows downslope from a higher point to a lower one. There was no other way of moving water except for small volume pumps and water wheels until the Industrial Revolution. Even today, gravity plays a central role in water management everywhere, even with long-distance aqueducts, such as those that feed vast cities like Los Angeles and Phoenix. Ancient Roman and Greek engineers were maestros of gravity-fed water delivery. So were the Chinese and the Inca of Peru. Dozens of smaller-scale societies and village farmers around the world still use gravity to irrigate their fields and to water their beasts. Some of them have maintained sustainable water supplies for centuries and are capable of doing so indefinitely if other users don't hijack their sources with pumps and earth-moving machinery. This book is a history of the triumph of gravity, the silent, ubiquitous force behind nearly all human relationships with water. Gravity lies behind the flexible, inexorable forces of water, but those who take advantage of it don't pretend to control them. The second theme is the close relationship between ritual and water management of all kinds. Water has a special place in all human societies. It's the essence of fertility and growth, of sustained life, associated with cleansing and renewal, with the spiritual forces of the cosmos. We've worshipped it and celebrated its magical flowing qualities, commemorated its mystical dimensions. We're in awe of water. As fisherfolk, sailors, and surfers, we respect its mysterious attractions. At the same time, it has an indispensable role in human life, for it lies behind everything we do, from cooking food and washing clothes, to agriculture, cattle herding, even baseball, tennis, and golf. Water is one of the few cultural universals, inspiring a profound mingling of ritual and day-to-day use. Ritual and religious beliefs surrounding water permeate every stage of human life, from birth to death. Christian infants are baptized in holy water. The ancient Egyptians and the Maya believed that their worlds began in the still waters of the primordium. Bronze Age farmers on the shores of the North Sea 3,000 years ago thought that their ancestors dwelled beneath the heaving waters of the ocean, the realm of the dead. Australian Aboriginal existence and much of its ritual revolves around knowledge of where water lies across the landscape. This book goes beyond hydrology and human ingenuity to explore some of the spiritual ties between ancient human societies and water. The third theme is technology versus sustainability, efforts at living within one's hydrological means. The past teaches us much about water management and has significant lessons for today and the future. Early theories about ancient irrigation conjured up dramatic images of slaves laboring waist-deep in mud at the bidding of a harsh supervisor's whip. Such scenarios featured anonymous regiments of laborers who transformed landscapes and created the underpinnings of pre-industrial civilizations like those of Mesopotamia and China. Famed movie producer Cecil B. DeMille might have dreamed of these lingering stereotypes, which are inaccurate at best, but occasionally still haunt the history books. In fact, some of the past's most effective irrigation works involved small villages and came online long before any great ruler ascended his throne. simple furrow irrigation, the diversion of stream and river water into nearby fields, is almost as old as farming itself, a logical step for villagers grappling with irregular rainfall, potential crop failures, and long dry seasons. Like their remote hunting and gathering ancestors, they were experts at managing risk, at sustaining life by turning to wild plants or hunting, by developing simple ways of bringing water in gently sloping furrows to their fields. Such self-sustaining water management survived far from the historical limelight in subsistence farming communities throughout the world for thousands of years. It still flourishes today in many places where the diesel engine and the turbine pump are but expensive dreams. This type of agriculture probably reaches its most sophisticated iteration among the rice farmers of Bali in Southeast Asia. Here, the allocation and management of water is in the hands of the farmers themselves and the deities, for ritual and irrigation are completely intertwined. Contrary to popular belief, village irrigation and local control of water remained very important long after the appearance of urban civilization in China, Egypt, and Mesopotamia. As I argue, the main interest of rulers and their officials was not in irrigation and water management as such, but in the food surpluses that they produced, which supported the state. Taxes collected in grain or labor were the mainstay of pre-industrial civilizations everywhere, where the many toiled for the benefit of the few. The Egyptian pharaohs presided over an agrarian kingdom where everyone had strong ties to ancestral villages and to the land. Each summer, an inundation flooded basins in the floodplain in a routine that went back centuries before the first divine king ruled Upper and Lower Egypt. The grain and labor of the villagers built the pyramids and great temples, and when there was a drought in about 2200 BCE, Egypt fell apart for more than 100 years. In response, later pharaohs embarked on much larger-scale irrigation works in places like the Fayum Depression to the west of the Nile and invested heavily in granaries. The same was true in Mesopotamia, where the early cities were little more than agglomerations of villages that came together in the face of increasingly scarce floodwaters. Circumstances changed as climate changes in the Indian Ocean caused major shifts in monsoon patterns after 2800 BCE. Summer no longer brought welcome rain to Mesopotamian farmers. Every village now relied more heavily on spring floods for irrigation water. More centralized control of irrigation works and water became imperative to ensure equitable distribution of water, especially in increasingly frequent drought years. In both Egypt and Mesopotamia, an army of officials now supervised canal maintenance and harvests, for careful water management made an immediate difference between famine and plenty for increasingly dense rural and urban populations. Inevitably, the scale of irrigation works grew and grew with the Assyrians and their small armies of prisoners of war, and with the Sasanians after them, who, like some Chinese emperors, transformed entire landscapes, sometimes with devastating ecological consequences. Southern Mesopotamian farmers had confronted increasing salinization from the early days of irrigation, handling it with, among other methods, systematic fallowing. But Mesopotamia later became a salt-ridden wilderness after the Sasanians took up 5 times more land under more irrigation than ever before in an insatiable quest for tax revenue and wealth. The result was promiscuous water usage and the ecological devastation of thousands of acres. The analogies with today's unthinking water usage in the American West are sobering. Some of China's large-scale irrigation works along the Huang River have contributed to the ecological crisis of endemic silting and water shortages that inflict the region today. Viewed in retrospect, such failed projects offer a sobering example of what happens to cities, farmers, landscapes, and indeed entire societies when sustainability evaporates. There were notable triumphs of technology and sustainability too, like in ancient Greek cities that made use of water-rich karst formations to provide reliable perennial water supplies for domestic use, agriculture, and waste disposal. The Romans, with their aqueducts, took a long-established technology and turned it into an architectural art form, as much as a matter of prestige and for public bathing as for reliable water supplies. Many of their water systems were sustainable over many centuries, even if they were wasteful. Roman expertise with water wheels and mills formed an important legacy for medieval Europe. The Romans did not invent such devices, but they used them with near industrial effect, grinding grain for Rome and communities like Arles. Anyone relying on gravity-derived water supplies had no option but to maintain a high degree of self-sustainability, especially in arid lands. The groundwater-tapping Kanats of Iran and the Puquios of the southern Andes, gravity-fed, humanly dug tunnels that tapped groundwater, were brilliant, simple inventions that determined where cities, towns, and villages were to lie. With such small-scale devices, you brought the settlement to the water. The Assyrians, Greeks, and Romans took another tack, sometimes using aqueducts for the reverse purpose. The peasants and engineers of medieval Islam were perhaps the most ingenious of all pre-industrial water managers. They used the simplest of technologies to wrest water from seemingly arid landscapes. As has become apparent in recent years, almost all water management in the Islamic world was ultimately based in the village, in the small farming community that designed its own water system based on the local contours, using dams and canals, large and small. When it came to cities, mosques, and palaces, the same simple gravity-based technologies, combined with water wheels and the labor of human and beast, came into play. By the 16th century, the European and Mediterranean worlds had reached the limits of gravity-driven water systems. 2 centuries later, the Industrial Revolution changed the entire water equation for humanity with pumps and earth-moving machinery that opened up hitherto inaccessible water supplies in the depths of the earth. In China, an 18th century Qing dynasty official named Chen Hongmao paid thousands of laborers to drain entire landscapes and dig canals that brought mountain water to lowland fields. Unbeknownst to him, Chinese water management was close to a point that it reached some time later, when nothing further could be done to manage water with the existing technology. Only a century after Chen's hard work, a new technological era had dawned on the other side of the world, which allowed governments to reshape entire landscapes and transport water over distances and mountain ranges as never before, with only a fraction of the unskilled human labor used by Chen. There's another major facet of humans' relationship with water that I don't explore in these pages. The use of water for both transport and voyaging, be it over a lake, up a river, or across an ocean. Until the domestication of the camel in the first millennium BCE, waterways, especially major rivers like the Euphrates, the Tigris, the Nile, and the Yangtze, provided much better ways of traveling than on foot or on the back of an ass or horse that required regular watering. Great rivers became highways from one village or city to another, and for moving goods of all kinds over distances, long and short. These journeys spawned breakthrough inventions like the planked boat and the sail. By 3000 BCE, sailing vessels were carrying timber and other heavy cargoes long distances with the aid of prevailing winds and river currents. From these inland ventures, it was a small step to coasting along Mediterranean and Persian Gulf shores, and from there to undertaking voyages to lands known and unknown, invisible over the far horizon. In fact, seafaring in a systematic way began much earlier than civilization, at least 45,000 years ago, off the coast of Southeast Asia. It took many millennia for human societies of all kinds to decipher the oceans. How exactly they did so remains one of the fascinating conundrums of history. What caused people to cross open water to uninhabited land dimly visible offshore on clear days? Was it food shortages or a lack of agricultural land? Or was it simply human curiosity? How and why did people in the southwestern Pacific decide to sail in outrigger canoes in search of islands deep in the unknown Pacific 3,000 years ago? What were the beliefs and spiritual relationships that sustained human societies as they colonized the Aleutian Islands or the Aegean Sea in the Mediterranean? I'll explore these numerous questions in my next book, which will be, in many respects, a sequel to this one. Elixir explores all manner of human societies, well-known and obscure. We cannot understand the complex relationships between humans and water without traveling far beyond the classic archaeological and historical stomping grounds of Europe, the Mediterranean, and Central America. Nor can we, as I once thought we could, visit the history of humans and water along a linear chronological track. My own experiences in Africa and elsewhere, and even a superficial examination of the literature on ancient water, soon made it clear that some extremely simple water management approaches, such as furrow irrigation, not only nourished farmland many thousands of years ago, but also thrive in self-sustaining societies into the 21st century. For this reason, the early chapters of the book examine furrow irrigation in a few ancient and still existing subsistence farming societies. The latter are self-sustaining in a world where much water management has moved far beyond sustainability. Some of these societies, like the Pokot of Kenya, administer their water systems by consensus and discussion. Others, like the rice farmers of Bali, depend on ancient rituals and long-established administrative and religious mechanisms to share water from upslope with farmers living much further downstream. The Bali system is so effective that Dutch colonial authorities and their successors failed to come up with anything more efficient. Then there's the remarkable case of the Hohokam of Arizona's Sonoran Desert, who flourished effortlessly in one of the driest environments in the Americas for 1,000 years before prolonged droughts during the medieval warm period caused a now much more elaborate farming society to implode. The contrast with the vast urban sprawl of today's Phoenix, which lies atop the Hohokam's ancient irrigation works, is both disturbing and enlightening. The middle chapters of the book do form a chronological gradient, telling the complex story of water management in the Mediterranean world. Here, we navigate some relatively familiar historical territory, and also examine much that has rarely emerged from the specialist literature. Like the study of ancient climate, archaeological studies of broad landscapes, as opposed to individual cities, towns, and villages, have gone through a scientific revolution in recent years. Today's archaeologists wear out shoe leather like their predecessors, but they now have a far wider range of tools to draw on. Aerial photographs, satellite maps, global positioning systems, GPSs, and other tools help them locate long-vanished canals and house mounds that give more complete pictures of ancient landscapes. When these are combined with historical data such as clay tablets, inscriptions, and papyri, it's astounding how much information can be teased from an ancient irrigated landscape, although many of them have, of course, been destroyed by later intensive farming activity. There were surprises for me here, too. For instance, startlingly few changes took hold in Egyptian water management over millennia. Sumerian irrigation in Mesopotamia was much less ambitious than I had assumed. The hydrological expertise of the Minoans of Crete and of the ancient Greeks was an eye-opener, for the Romans copied many of their water devices, including siphon technology, which had originated much earlier in the Near East on a more modest scale. From the Mediterranean world, we travel to India and Southeast Asia, to a world of cisterns and dams, where monsoon rains played a central role in maintaining sustainability. Here again, new discoveries are rewriting history, as the scale of water management works at sites like Anuradhapura in Sri Lanka and the city of Vijayanagar, one of the largest cities in ancient South Asia, is becoming apparent after centuries of relative historical obscurity. Then there's Angkor in Cambodia, where water is seemingly abundant, but where recent fieldwork in the hinterland surrounding Angkor Wat shows that monsoon failures and drought drastically affected the Khmer Empire and may even have contributed to its collapse. China offers another dramatic contrast, a land of two worlds, the south, with its abundant water and rice agriculture, and the far more challenged north, where famine, drought, and water shortages have haunted village farmers since the beginnings of farming life. The ambitious plans that today's China has for moving water from the south to the north have deep roots in history, where emperors' minions set thousands to work building long canals and miles of dikes. Water management in ancient America, discussed next, offers striking parallels between the water problems at Angkor and those of the ancient Maya, to whom irrigation was unknown and whose farmers relied on raised fields in swamps and on tropical subsistence farming. In the end, prolonged droughts were one of the causes of the collapse of much of Maya civilization in the 10th century CE, whereas the Andeans survived drought after drought along the arid Peruvian coast through conservative, careful water management. The Inca, high in the Andes, were water engineers of genius and triumphant users of gravity. Finally, we return to the Near East and West. Humans have always lived in unpredictable environments where water resources lie irregularly distributed across the landscape. That landscape can be arid, with only seasonal rainfall or virtually no rainfall at all. Such was the world of Islam, whose water engineers designed gardens that truly offer a blueprint for paradise in a water-deprived world. However, Islamic water management faltered, in part because of drier conditions and political upheavals, as well as growing populations, but primarily because their engineers came up against the limitations of their technology and lacked the circumstances to innovate. Instead, it was medieval Europe, with its plentiful water, that ultimately developed the technologies that changed human relationships with water during the 19th century. This book is about changing human relationships with water over thousands of years. Our story is a complex meld of climate change, gravity, human modifications of the natural environment, and technological innovation, kept in balance by intricate ritual observance and religious belief. There are many smaller-scale societies around the world that manage their water in sustainable ways, and will continue to do so if the greedy maw of industrial civilization does not shrink groundwater levels and divert streams. Even during drought cycles, the most resilient of these societies survive. As the Hohokam teach us, it was ultimately their success, reflected in rising populations and increased social complexity, that did many of them in. Then there are the rest of us, who take water for granted as it comes out of faucets or stands on supermarket racks in plastic bottles. Most of the water we pump from deep aquifers supports agriculture, helping provide the food that we buy in the same markets. We rarely think of water as a finite resource that may one day dry up as we play a round of golf, fill our swimming pool on a hot summer day, or water our lawn. As small regiments of writers quite rightly lament, we're long past the frontiers of water sustainability, especially in areas like the American West, Australia, and the Near East. We live in the industrial age of water as a commodity, yet alongside us thrive much smaller societies that use water wisely, as they always have. Now we are entering a new era caused by our own wastefulness. The new era of carefully husbanded water supplies is one of conservation. History teaches us that the societies that last longest are those that treat water with respect, as an elixir of life, a gift from the gods. We seem to have forgotten this compelling lesson. Table of Major Developments and Events. Circa 10,500 BCE, agriculture in the Near East. Unknown date, earliest efforts at furrow irrigation. Before 7000 BCE, earliest known well in Cyprus. Before 5000 BCE, furrow irrigation in Wadi Finan, Jordan, irrigation in Chogomami, Iraq. Before 4500 BCE, irrigation agriculture well established in southern Mesopotamia and Egypt. 3800 BCE, southern Mesopotamia becomes drier. circa 3100 BCE, Sumerian, Mesopotamian, and Egyptian civilization come into being. 2700 to 1900 BCE, mature Harappan civilization in the Indus Valley. 2334 BCE, Sumerian civilization overthrown by King Sargon of Akkad. 2297 to 2198 BCE, alleged dates of Yu the Great, pioneer Chinese hydrological engineer. Circa 2000 BCE, extensive irrigation works by the pharaohs in Egypt's Fayum Depression. Circa 1600 BCE, sophisticated water management at the Minoan palace of Minos, Knossos, Crete. Circa 1500 BCE, maize agriculture and irrigation in the American Southwest. After 1366 BCE, Assyrians rise to power in northern Mesopotamia. 883 to 859 BCE, Assyrian monarch Assurnasipal II builds canals, a tunnel, and irrigation works at Kalhu, Nimrud, northern Iraq. 714 BCE, the Assyrian ruler Sargon II admires a kanat in Urartu, Iran, the first record of such a water device. 704 to 681 BCE, Assyrian king Sennacherib's irrigation works at Nineveh. 612 BCE, Nineveh sacked by Babylonian conquerors. 6th century BCE, Marib Dam, Yemen, constructed. 594 BCE, Solon promulgates water regulations in Athens. 560 BCE, first large-scale Chinese canal digging. After 550 BCE, kanats spread with the Achaemenid Empire, 550 to 330 BCE. 539 BCE, Cyrus the Great captures Babylon. 530 BCE, Eupalinus constructs his water tunnel on Samos. 323 BCE, death of Alexander the Great. 323 BCE to 224 CE, Seleucid and Parthian rule in Mesopotamia. 312 BCE, Aqua Appia, Rome's first aqueduct, built. 4th century BCE to the 11th century CE, Anuradhapura flourishes in northern Sri Lanka. 300 BCE, Ptolemy I Sota founds a library and museum in Alexandria, an important center of technological development. 258 to 237 BCE, major drainage and irrigation works in Egypt's Fayum under Ptolemy II and III. 256 BCE, construction of the Dujiangyan irrigation system, Sichuan province, China, still in use. 110 BCE to the 6th century CE, Himyarite kingdom in Yemen. 1st century BCE, vertical water wheels widespread in the eastern Mediterranean world. 25 BCE, Marcus Vitruvius Pollio publishes his De Architectura. 11 CE, Sanyang Zhuang inundated in northern China. 50, Segovia, Spain's aqueduct, constructed. 97, Sextus Julius Frontinus appointed water commissioner for Rome. 224 to 651, Sasanian Empire. Circa 400, possible irrigation agriculture in Bali, known to be well established by the 8th century. Circa 450, Hohokam farmers in the American Southwest. 622, the Prophet Muhammad's Hegira to Medina, Yathrib. 640, Islam spreads to Syria, Palestine, Egypt, and Libya. 711, Islamic conquest of Spain, Al-Andalus, begins. 1113, founding of Angkor Wat, Cambodia, by Khmer King Suryavarman II. 1300, overshot watermills in widespread use in medieval Europe. Early 14th century, Vijayanagar founded in southern India. 1431, Khmer civilization based on Angkor collapses. 1492, Al-Andalus becomes part of Christian Spain. Circa 1500, Hohokam societies implode. Circa 16th century, irrigation in Ngaruka, Tanzania. Similar furrow irrigation, probably well established elsewhere in sub-Saharan Africa by this time. 1696 to 1771, lifespan of Chen Hongmao, influential Chinese irrigation expert. 1752, primitive New Coman steam engine pumps water for London. 1753, Frederick the Great completes drainage of the Oder marshes. Circa 1762-64, 1769, invention of the spinning jenny and water frame for cotton spinning. 1776, James Watt develops the first commercially viable steam engine as part of the Industrial Revolution. 1907-1924, New York's Catskill Aqueduct system developed. 1913, opening of the Owens Aqueduct, which supplied water to Los Angeles. 1931-36, construction of the Hoover Dam. Part 1. Canals, furrows, and rice paddies. Living from one rainy season to the next, in which we visit Australian Aborigines and the earliest water management of all, explore furrow irrigation in ancient and modern sub-Saharan Africa, trace ancient canal systems in the Arizona desert, and decipher the intricacies of ritual and rice farming in Bali. Chapter 1. The Elixir of Life. Ingombi Ilede, the place where the cow sleeps, lies on the floodplain of Central Africa's Middle Zambezi Valley, near the hamlet of Lusitu, in Zambia, downstream of the rugged Kariba Gorge. 4 years in the making, the giant Kariba Dam blocked the Middle Zambezi River in 1959, forming a lake that covers 2,150 square miles, 5,580 square kilometers, as part of a huge Central African hydroelectric project. The government of what was then Northern Rhodesia forcibly resettled 57,000 Gwembe Tonga farmers, whose ancestors had lived upstream of the dam site for many centuries. Many of them came to villages around Lusitu. They found themselves in a much less productive location, for they had always farmed small riverside gardens watered by the Zambezi's spring floods. Now the floods were gone. The re-engineered river flowed between tall banks, its gravity-propelled momentum controlled by giant dam sluices. The only water for the villagers' fields came from 5 months of irregular rainfall in a low-lying environment where droughts were commonplace. Almost immediately, there was hunger and thirst. Belatedly, the colonial government sunk boreholes. The groundwater was unpleasantly salty, so the engineers decided to pump water from the river instead. A network of small pipelines would converge on a pair of storage tanks located on the highest point around, Ingombi Ilede. A compact pump house with 2 diesel pumps sat atop the ridge, which was why I came to Lusitu in 1961. The excavations for the foundations had disturbed 9 richly decorated human burials, the remains of ivory traders who had settled in this remote place, far from the Indian Ocean, during the 15th century CE. My late colleague, James Chaplin, had cleared the graves as quickly as possible, chivied along by the contractor, who was anxious to finish work. Months later, I arrived to date the site, I got it wrong, and locate any further burials. I found only a couple, both undecorated. It was then that I first witnessed the complex relationships between humans and water, deployed in full array within a few miles. Few places offered such hydrological contrasts. Some 30 miles, 43 kilometers, upstream stood the menacing semicircle of the Kariba Dam, a concrete arch 420 feet, 128 meters high. The dam had tamed one of the largest rivers in the world at huge cost to provide electricity for cities and copper mines hundreds of miles away. This vast, expensive structure did nothing for the Gwembe Tonga. Traditionally, village women and girls had collected water in clay pots from the Zambezi and its side streams. They did the same at Lusitu, but the distances were longer, the banks less accessible. Now the Ingombi Ilede pump house would transform the villagers' lives, or so the local government officer told me. Standpipes in each village would bring Zambezi water within easy reach of every household, even if they had to carry it to their homes. Here, timeless practice and modern-day rural plumbing, powered by diesel pumps, stood side by side. The Tonga now had a reliable water supply, comparable to that experienced by urban Romans and medieval Londoners, as long as the pumps kept working. Even then, young and fresh out of university, I was struck by the palimpsest of relationships between water and people within a tiny geographical area. To the dam builders, water was a commodity, a means to an end. To the colonial government, standpipes were a gift from a munificent authority, a convenient solution to an inconvenient thirst problem, nothing more. But to the Tonga, it was life, one of the ways of defining their society. Gravity controls river floods, creates runoff, replenishes groundwater with rainwater, and fills lakes and watering holes. In ancient times, water came from three sources, from nearby lakes, rivers, and springs, from groundwater close to the surface reached by wells or through natural water seeps, and from a distance, often with human assistance. Everyone, whether African farmer, Maya lord, Andean noble, or Egyptian official, had to acquire water by obeying the fundamental rule of gravity. Water flows downhill. The changing human relationship with water throughout history, which I think of as being in the three broad stages outlined in the preface, inspires endless important questions. When did our forebears first harness flowing streams and divert them onto their fields? What special knowledge did they need to do so, and how did they acquire it? Astonishing, although it may seem, and as we shall see, such simple diversion works still sustain many farming societies to this day. How did such people survive for centuries in extremely arid environments, where virtually all water came not from the heavens, but from rivers that flowed far over the horizon? What was the role of prolonged droughts and other climate changes in defining sustainability? What happened when more complex societies harnessed gravity to irrigate not just a few fields, but entire landscapes? When this happened, who controlled water supplies and crop yields? Where did the power lie? Was it vested in the village, or in a palace or temple? This is a history as much of common folk as of powerful lords and divine kings, a story of people quietly going about their daily routine in worlds governed by the passage of seasons, by floods, and by complex relationships with the supernatural. To the Gwembe Tonga of the 1960s, water was a precious substance. It still is. Every October, they watched massive black thunderclouds piling up over the mountains on the far side of the valley. Flashes of lightning and occasional thunderclaps rent the heavens, but all too often they merely raised the temperature and brought no rain. When the showers came, they could drench one village and leave another a mile away completely dry. Drought was a way of life in the Zambezi Valley, where farming was a high-risk endeavor. I watched the farmers plant with the first showers. A few weeks later, we would walk through freshly planted fields where maize, millet, and sorghum withered in the hot sun. The Tonga were stoic and could at least rely on fellow kin in nearby villages to help them out. I witnessed in unforgettable ways how rainfall and the river defined their lives and those of their crops, and I remembered Ecclesiastes, "All the rivers run into the sea." Yet the sea is not full. Unto the place from whence the rivers come, thither they return again. Like the Tonga, we all live with a quiet reality. Water is the principal constituent of all living organisms, making up 65% of human bodies, so that without access to dependable water supplies, such as a spring or a cistern, any form of activity is difficult. Survival may be at stake. When we perspire, we lose water, which has to be replaced as soon as possible. The amount varies, depending on where you live. People dwelling in desert climates may sweat off as much as 2.6 gallons, 10 liters, a day, but a vast majority of human water consumption goes toward agriculture. And of course, plants are also vulnerable to water deficits, especially in arid and semi-arid lands, where up to more than 99% of the water absorbed by their roots is lost in the dry atmosphere around them. Cereal crops are especially sensitive to a lack of water to replace that lost through the process of transpiration, equivalent to sweating in animals. Faced with a lack of water to draw from the soil, a plant first suffers from dehydration, then wilts and dies. In many dry areas, rain falls irregularly, usually during a relatively short, wet season. Meanwhile, the atmosphere remains thirsty and draws moisture from the vegetation. Water evaporates from the soil and also percolates downward. Even a few weeks without moisture can cause a crop to wither or fail altogether. Water is capricious and powerful, far more masterful than the humans and animals that depend upon it. This is why gravity and irrigation play such important roles in human history. Irrigation. The very word conjures up images of lush golf courses and green river valleys teeming with growing crops of agriculture on a grand scale. We have visions of great irrigation works of the past. We think of finely dressed officials supervising the digging and maintenance of canals. Small armies of villagers gather in the harvest under their watchful eyes. Diligent scribes count every sheaf, tablets close at hand. We've admired, too, many ancient Egyptian tomb paintings of the harvest on noblemen's estates, where scribes assess taxes as the owner leans on his staff. In fact, and contrary to popular belief, almost all ancient irrigation flourished off the historical radar screen in the hands of local communities. For a while, irrigation defined ancient civilizations in academic circles. A half century ago, a distinguished historian, Carl Wittfogel, wrote what soon became a classic work on water and early civilization. Oriental Despotism, a Comparative Study of Total Power, described the early civilizations of Mesopotamia, the Nile, and the Indus River of South Asia as hydraulic civilizations. The substance of his argument was that extensive irrigation works produced huge agricultural surpluses. He believed that water management on this scale required an elaborate bureaucratic infrastructure and economic centralization, which led to the development of urban societies and the first civilizations. Despotic leaders with total power ruled new forms of hierarchical societies based on cities. A form of developmental cycle came into being where more elaborate water systems and larger food surpluses helped create increasingly hierarchical societies. As food and water surpluses continued to mount, the societies became ever larger and more elaborate. Thus, irrigation was a prime cause of civilization. Wittfogel was a pioneer who wrote at a time when virtually nothing was known of ancient irrigation systems around the world, even in his core areas, China and Mesopotamia. With the hindsight of more than 50 years, we know that his notion of hydraulic civilizations masks a far more complex reality. For instance, archaeological surveys have shown conclusively that both the early Sumerians and the Egyptians did not develop elaborate irrigation works for many centuries after cities appeared along the Tigris, the Euphrates, and the Nile. In reality, the state was usually an outsider, its primary interests lying in crop yields and taxation in food and labor. The large food surpluses that filled urban granaries came from dozens of small rural communities producing far more food than the small surpluses they would normally grow for their own uses. I believe that for most of history, the power over water management and food supplies resided ultimately in the hands of local communities. Before the Kariba resettlement, the Gwembe Tonga combined subsistence farming based on irregular rainfall with the cultivation of small plots by the river nourished by receding floodwaters in late spring and early summer. Otherwise, they drew water from the river or even drank it out of their hands, just as hunter-gatherers have done since the beginning of time. Like farmers, such people have extremely complex and intimate relationships with water and the way it is distributed across the landscape. Take the case of the Australian Aborigines. The direct ancestors of the Australian Aborigines settled in their arid homeland at least 45,000 years ago. The unpredictability of water supplies makes for an uneasy relationship with the natural world. Aboriginal groups see themselves not as the managers of their environment, but rather as people in a state of constant apprehension and negotiation with it. It follows that knowledge of water sources and their uses is an important part of how Aborigines feel about who they are and of their perceptions and experiences of their landscape. Over thousands of years, they developed sophisticated adaptations to some of the harshest environments on Earth, defined in large part by water sources. Sparse desert populations lived in a state of continual flux. When heavy rains brought standing water and replenished natural wells, the people would move out over wider areas. As supplies evaporated, they would forage their way inward, moving with the diminishing water, until months of drought forced them to camp near the few more or less permanent water sources at their disposal. These they used, last of all, in an endless, irregular rhythm of movement dictated by rainfall. Fission often followed, then aggregation with small groups of related families anchored to more permanent water sources during extended droughts. Everyone was at the mercy of a capricious and totally unpredictable water pump that could inundate the desert in hours, then dry up, leaving a baked, utterly desiccated world in its train. To the Australian Aborigines, water is sacred, even elemental, and the source of life. Water is elusive in their generally arid homeland, its sources inconspicuous. It is far more than merely a physical resource. The distribution of water across the landscape defines most hunting and foraging. Aboriginal relationships with water sources of all kinds are both social, delineated by kin and other ties, and spiritual, part of how they know and understand the world. As they travel across their home territories, each band invokes local traditions of ancestors and spiritual beings. These traditions provide knowledge and power, good luck, and ways of avoiding misfortune. Rites to water sources and to hunting territories are held in common with other members of kin-based groups. Their territory consists of places that evoke profound sacred associations, important memories, and social obligations, a hard-learned landscape of memory and social meaning. Since the beginning, walking tracks have crossed the arid center of Australia, each following chains of water sources known to generations of hunters. These are dreaming tracks, or songlines, whose paths are recorded in traditional dances, songs, and tales, as well as in paintings. A knowledgeable Aborigine can navigate the landscape by repeating the words of songlines. Some lines cover only a few miles. Many others, long, memorized paths through the desert that link dozens of water sources, some good, others at best marginal, but enough to connect a band with better supplies further along. Water knowledge of the locations of sources, reliable and ephemeral, the telltale signs of such places, and the names of them, passes meticulously from generation to generation. Think of long-established medieval pilgrimage routes, memorizing subway stops in New York, or a bicycle route through San Francisco, and you get part of the idea. Each generation learns what each source can yield, from a deep pool containing thousands of gallons of fresh water shaded in a deep gorge, to the few cupfuls that survive in the hollow branches of a eucalyptus tree. In Western Arnhem Land, for example, hunters define their territories in terms of locations. Ingenious, Point David, Waterhole. Sacred site of Jurwa, the green-backed turtle, metamorphosed in stone. Wunuri or Gwunjuri, camp and hunting centre. Water runs from the 9 Mile to Warilij, which is good for hunting possum and collecting wild honey. Sequences like this, maps as it were, passed from generation to generation, can juxtapose a sacred mythological monster, a campsite, and a hunting place. They are linked along a pathway of movement, experience, and memory that changes constantly. The tracks and water sources lie in the midst of a landscape thwart with social and spiritual dangers. A band member is only truly safe if he or she is living with close relatives in a territory to which they belong. It is among such people that the knowledge of how to avoid danger, of how to navigate the landscape safely, resides. Many groups describe their territories by prominent landmarks, including rivers, creeks, and waterholes. They also construct their personal and group identities on the basis of ancestral origins, which are mainly expressed in terms of precious water sources. Knowledge of these places resides with the elders, men and women of unquestioned authority, who have spent much of their lives acquiring first-hand knowledge of the landscape. Their knowledge comes from ceremonies and rituals, from chants, songs, and recitations. Genealogies and local histories are part of the narrative, as are their communications with the ancestral beings and ancestors, who are said to frequent water sources. The elders invoke spiritual protection for their juniors and have authority over access to and use of locations where water is to be found. They decide who receives the knowledge and who joins their company. They select mature individuals who have passed through the appropriate initiation rites and are deemed capable of maintaining the tight veil of secrecy that surrounds the knowledge. The elders' knowledge goes back to what is called the dreaming, or dream time. Awareness of the dreaming pervades Aboriginal life, the period of creation, a time in the distant past, long ago. Australia was featureless and uninhabited before its transformation by ancestral beings, part animal, part human. The mythic beings of the dreaming are heroic figures, endowed with supernatural powers. Every meaningful activity, every event, leaves behind a residue in the earth, just as plants leave seeds behind them. Streams, waterholes, and other places echo the events that created them. Everything in the environment is a symbolic footprint left by the mythic beings which created the world. They hunted and foraged, just like humans, but in so doing, they created salient features of the landscape. In Western Australia, the wagyl, a sacred serpent, meandered over the dry landscape, creating lakes and waterways, among them the Swan River. Other snakes created winding creeks and waterholes. A lizard man's stone axe would carve a gap between two hills. The eggs laid by an emu ancestress would turn into oval boulders. Stories of water creation abound, always with mythic beings involved. One such story tells us that back in the first time, when everything was new, a hunting band camped on a mountain in a drought. The band's water sources ran dry. Two greedy members of the group stole the last of the water and ran away with it when everyone was asleep. The elders found the tracks of the two thieves, and the band hunted them down. Spears were thrown, one punctured the water carrier, which began to leak. Eventually, the two men were captured. Strong punitive magic turned one into the first emu, the other into the first blue-tongued lizard. But a wonderful thing had happened. Wherever the water had leaked onto the plains, there were now beautiful billabongs, or waterholes. There was grass and flowers and lovely water lilies, and then there were shrubs and trees. And soon the birds came, and everyone was happy, because there was enough water for everyone. In another story, two kurias, giant crocodiles, seized a man's two wives as they bathed in a spring. He hunted the beasts down and speared them as their tails lashed a hollow in the mud. Then he cut them open and rescued his wives. Each year, the hollow, now the Narran Lake in New South Wales, fills with water. Every Aboriginal band thinks of the landmarks and water sources in its territory in terms of what the beings of the dreaming wrought. The power of the original creative beings surrounds humans on every side. Myths, songs, and ritual are powerful and vibrant forces in Aboriginal life, just as they are in other hunter-gatherer societies. The law of the dreaming revolves around reciprocity and cooperation between individuals and groups, essential in arid environments. The rights to live in and exploit a hunting territory depend on at least one member of the band having a connection with ancestors, preferably at the generation of grandparents. The social networks of each band extend over far wider areas, to the extent that people who marry into another band still retain rights to their original homeland through descent and alliance. But to exercise their rights means having some knowledge of both the territory and, most important, its spiritual landscape. These relationships based on knowledge, especially between elders, extend over long distances, far further than the regular face-to-face contacts within a band or neighbouring groups. Inherited friendships and other such social mechanisms are powerful factors in the Aboriginal relationship to water, for everyone has obligations to water from the past that extend deep into the future to their descendants. The Australian Aborigines have an intensely local identification with water sources, especially springs, in ways that contrast dramatically with the much larger scale identities of other societies throughout the world, like Bali rice farmers, or long ago ancient Egyptians, whose realms can encompass a water source far away in the mountains or an entire great river. For the Aborigines, water and water places are constructed socially for the band through the experiences of the elders who dwell in these places, which to them are also spiritscapes. The complex and profoundly personal relationships between the Australian Aborigines and their water have deep roots in the past and surely extend back deep into the Ice Age, although as yet we cannot prove this. The power of the dreaming resides in the waters. Almost all hunter-gatherers live in mobile bands. They can move across the landscape in search of water. Farming communities are literally rooted in place. For them, water is a shared resource subject to the tyranny of sloping terrain. To manage any downslope flow requires careful planning and the excavation of communally owned channels. The routine of irrigation depends on reliable and equitable delivery of water to each field, whether up or down canal. Digging and maintaining channels, scheduling watering days and the amount of water for each owner, carrying out emergency repairs in times of flood, these are the kinds of details that require not administrative fiat, but complex negotiations between members of kin groups, between landholders up and downstream, often between neighbouring villages. Every irrigation system, however large and complex, works best when decision-making is flexible, as much as possible left in the hands of the irrigators themselves. If individual communities are left alone to make their own decisions, much greater stability ensues, with conflicts over delivery, and these are inevitable, settled locally. I once witnessed a violent argument between two Zambezi Valley families over access to a well. By the time the argument was over, a crowd had gathered. Relatives and neighbours joined in with gusto. In the end, the village head man settled the dispute after listening to both sides. In the past, as today, these groups were basically egalitarian societies where power lay with the ancestors, with kin leaders, and in the powerful hands of public opinion. Irrigation canals might only flow for a few miles, but their digging and maintenance lay in the hands of everyone, the only way the community could maintain sustainable life. Among the Sonjo farmers of Tanzania, for example, a man who refused to participate in canal maintenance paid a fine in goats. It's no coincidence that many such societies survive to this day in various parts of the world. They may be riven with factionalism, sometimes resort to violence, or break apart and reform in a different way, but in the long term, they enjoy a level of sustainability that is unique in its flexibility. Many studies of ancient water management concern themselves almost entirely with the mechanics of dams and irrigation canals, with such devices as pumps and water wheels. In the final analysis, however, as Spanish scholar Miquel Barcelo has pointed out, everything depended on the human beings behind the technology. It was people who thought through the general design of an irrigation system, however localized. They looked at the topography, the direction and gradient of the water flow, knowing that everything depended on gravity. They selected a catchment point, carefully laid out the direction and gradient of the supply canals before digging them, cited storage reservoirs if needed, and, if they were in use, located the positions of water mills for grinding grain. The course of the main supply canal dictated the layout of the entire system, for the realities of gravity flow meant that the potential for expanding the system declined steadily the further the water travelled from the catchment point. For this reason, most irrigation systems were local and of small size. For all their human dimensions, they were ultimately artifacts, but artifacts that worked well because of the flexible social institutions associated with them. Subsistence farmers place great emphasis on kin ties and the inheritance of farming land, and on their close relationships with the guardians of that land, the ancestors. Since most village-based irrigation and water management offers few opportunities for expansion, about the only solution is for people to move and found another settlement some distance away, using other water sources while maintaining social ties. For example, in the Maghreb region of extreme northwest Africa, farmers dwelled, and sometimes still dwell, in fortified villages located just above the main irrigation canal. The irrigation terraces lay below the village in serried rows, the fortifications being a reflection of competition for farming land. Such fortified Berber villages go back to at least the 3rd century CE and also occurred in Libya, far to the east. In places like the Maghreb, Islamic Spain, Mexico, and the Andes, the long-term sustainability of water management involved an enormous expenditure of human labor, but once built, raised gardens or terraces could result in huge savings in labor, as their builders well knew. Carl Wittfogel was absolutely correct in drawing attention to the importance of irrigation agriculture to pre-industrial civilizations. But in fact, water delivery and management had a much broader spectrum. Every early urban civilization acquired water from afar, in the case of Egypt, the Indus Valley and Mesopotamia, from great rivers whose sources were hundreds of miles upstream. Diversion ditches and earthworks, cisterns, dams, long tunnels that tapped groundwater and wells, the range of ingenious devices was enormous. No early civilization, except perhaps the Khmer of Southeast Asia, and even they had drought problems, had the benefit of inexhaustible rivers with reliable flow at all times of the year. Some had almost no access to large rivers at all. Irrigation agriculture formed part of the apparatus of sustainability and took many forms. There were irrigation systems designed to supply water to cities, towns, and villages, whose purposes were mainly domestic, and which, in the case of the Islamic world, provided water for ritual ablutions. The Romans built aqueducts at enormous expense to provide water for baths, palaces, public fountains, or military encampments. Most irrigation provided water for agriculture, for food production of all kinds. Almost always locally designed and constructed, such systems relied on complex yet flexible water technology and a detailed understanding of the local environment. For example, generations of scholars have assumed that the Romans, with their imposing aqueducts and dams, developed the water management systems of their colonies in North Africa. In fact, Berber farmers had developed their own sustainable irrigation works several thousand years before the Romans attempted to commodify water management with only partial success. Simple but highly effective Berber irrigation techniques spread into Al-Andalus with the Islamic conquest of Spain in the 8th century, and they provided the basis not only for village water management deep in the countryside, but also for the river-based systems that supplied towns and cities. The size of the irrigation system made no difference, for all of them were founded on the basic principle that water flow follows gradients. As time went on, the scale of irrigation works increased to encompass entire river valleys and landscapes. This expansion was a product of ever larger political entities and tax-hungry rulers, but also of wars and other miseries that created mushrooming armies of convicts, prisoners of war, and slaves to dig canals, drain marshes, and build aqueducts. Some of the largest irrigation works were those of the Sasanians in Mesopotamia during the 6th century CE, which expanded existing acreage under cultivation at least fivefold. Their diversions of the Tigris were extremely high risk and involved massive investment in manpower, and their irrigation works soon backfired in the face of political instability, widespread famine, and reduced yields, caused in part by rising salinity in poorly drained floodplain soils. More than a millennium was to pass before another nation engineered a watershed and reclaimed land on such a scale during the Industrial Revolution, with German works in the Rhine Basin. Our ancient forebears revered water. Many small farming societies imagined that their world began in fathomless, still waters. The ancient Egyptians believed that their world had three basic elements: earth, sun, and water. Their existence began with none, the primeval waters of nothingness. Then the god Atum, the completed one, the creator, preeminent over the cosmos, emerged from the watery chaos. He caused the first moment, raising a mound of solid earth above the waters. Then the life-giving force of the sun, Re, rose over the land to cause the rest of creation. The pharaohs believed that the life-giving waters of the Nile came from a subterranean stream that flowed in the underworld. Invariably, water was a gift of the gods. The Book of Revelation in the New Testament speaks of the angel of the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God. In the Old Testament, Psalm 63 links rivers with the Lord. You care for the land and water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. You drench its furrows and level its ridges. You soften it with showers and bless its crops. Water enjoyed sacred properties in many ancient societies as the source of life. The Holy Quran teaches again and again that with water we made all living things. Throughout Islamic domains, water devices of all kinds were far more than mere artifacts. A bubbling fountain celebrated the sacred mysteries of water and provided spiritual solace. Allah's throne sat on the waters in the highest world of all. In Central America, Maya lords performed elaborate public water rituals atop great pyramids that also served as rainfall catchments. Their artists sometimes depicted the sacred world tree, which linked the layers of their cosmos, as a maize plant rising from bands of water. Maize was the sustainer of Maya life. The water lily monster served as the symbol of a watery world of raised fields and swamps. In Bali, farmers still irrigate their terraced rice fields on a schedule dictated by gods and goddesses residing in mountains and lakes high above the fields through a hierarchy of water temples. Much of this reverence revolved and revolves around the close connections between fertility, human life, and abundant water, around water as life. But where did it come from? Almost all ancient societies believed that water flowed from the depths of the earth. The Nile appeared to emerge from an utterly arid desert. The ancient Greeks considered springs to be sacred gifts emanating from the underworld. Few Europeans believed that rain and snow could provide water, at least until Leonardo da Vinci suggested it. Few people believed him. Eventually, during the 17th century, the English astronomer Edmund Halley and, quite independently, the French architect and scientist Claude Perrault used measurements of the catchments of the Thames and Seine rivers to prove Da Vinci correct. Today, we know that water, like living organisms, has a life cycle, a circulation. It falls to earth as rain or snow, some on land, much of it at sea. Much of that descending on land drains into the ocean above or below ground. The remainder evaporates back into the atmosphere either directly or through vegetation, absorbing water from the ground and releasing it into the air as vapor. Vapor from both land and sea condenses into new rain-giving clouds. The world's oceans are, as it were, a huge reservoir. So much of this water is salt. Only the water temporarily withdrawn from the ocean is fresh. Only about 8.6 billion cubic miles, 36 billion cubic kilometers, of fresh water is on Earth. A mere 30% of that circulates relatively fast. The remainder is trapped in polar ice sheets or is under the surface, in aquifers or as groundwater. Some stays below ground for thousands of years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.